Prince of darkness grim, we tremble not for him, his rage we can't.
Right, everybody ready? Well, good morning. Good to see all of you. My name's Nicole Jesse, and you are at Walnut Hill Bible Church. So if that's where you were hoping to be this morning, you're here. And good morning to everyone downstairs in 180, and good morning to everyone that's watching us online as well. If you're visiting with us today, welcome. I see a few friendly visiting faces. So if you'd like to make a connection with us, we would love to do that with you. And you can do that a couple of ways. We'll be out at the welcome desk in the foyer after service. We'd love to meet you there. We also have welcome cards in the pews. We also have prayer cards in the pews, for that matter, if you have a prayer request or praise you'd like to submit to the church. And if you're joining us online, if you go to our website, there is an I'm New Here feature, and if you click on that, it'll walk you through how to make an introduction. All right, we have more baby news. It's like the best part of the morning, and this one's a two-for-one. So go ahead, show those boys. We have the Emirate twins, and they were born this past Monday to David and Becky, and that is Landon and Garrett, as you can see there. Landon, I believe, was 5 pounds, 8 ounces, and Garrett was just under that at 4 pounds, 10 ounces. So we are just praising God for these two little miracles, and if you get a chance to congratulate David and Becky, or if you see Dale Emery, or if you see the Cyberlings, make sure you are just giving them a huge old congratulations. All right, you should each have a postcard that has our Easter Holy Week service schedule in it. We do have a few extra, and I would be more than happy to print more if you'd like to hand them out as invitations. So this is going to be what's going on Palm Sunday, regular services. Maundy, Thursday, we are going to have a potluck and then a service with communion. Good Friday, 7 o'clock service, and then on Easter, we are just going to celebrate all morning. So we'll start with the sunrise service, we will have 3 worship services, and we will also have a breakfast served between 7 and 10:30 that you can just come and eat and then come to service. So if you'd like more of these to hand out, please let me know if they run out in the foyer, and I'll get you more. And now Ruth Davidson has an announcement that she'd like to come on up and make.
Good morning, everybody. I just wanted to point out, I know it's in your bulletins as well, but next week is March 26th, and Gina Ramason, who is our missionary with her husband Syed in India, is going to be coming to visit to give an update, but also following is lunch on from each service. So us from the Missions Board just wanted to point that out to you guys as a super cool opportunity to get to know her since she is new to our church, and also get to hear about her ministry there in India. So just a fun update for you guys.
And it's always fun to have Ruth up here, isn't it? All right, so thank you so much. All right, moving on, you also have an insert in your bulletins for the Women's Conference. So this is our annual Women's Conference that we have at Walnut Hill Bible Church, and it gives you information on how to sign up there. But we just want to let you know we are going to have a live worship team, and then we have, as you can see on the insert, we have some speakers from our church that are going to be bringing you teaching, encouragement, devotions, and we're going to pair that up with some hand-picked video content. So there's a lot here for this conference. We want you to sign up, ladies. Church Center app, you can sign up on the website under our events, or there's a QR code that if you aim your phone at it, it should take you to the registration. So go ahead and register. We're going to be doing that for the next few weeks, so we encourage you to do that. And just a few reminders, you saw the children's art exhibit that's out in the foyer. Kids, amazing job. You just have done just awesome. Can we give them a round of applause? Yeah, praise God for you guys. And the adult art exhibit, the registration has closed, but I just want to remind you, if you haven't brought your art exhibit entries, you're going to want to go home and bring those back. So we want to get those here today. If you have any questions, let Mary know. Today's the last day to sign up for the women's book pre-order for the Tuesday morning Bible study. And then next Sunday kicks off that children's Easter story time in the library. So a lot going on. Easter season is coming. Thank you.
Good morning, church. Today's a special day, a day we affectionately know around here as Irish Sunday. And many of you look forward to this day as often as Brayton is available, and because it all hinges on him. But so Friday was St. Patrick's Day, and just because we can, we like to give things a little Irish flavor on a day like today. Not to celebrate a person or a saint. That's not our goal this morning, okay? But we want to use this opportunity to reflect on the fact that God's praise and God's people are not limited to this country. And it goes to all the nations. And his praise is happening around the globe this morning, and we get to be a part of that. But his praise is going to sound a little different from one nation to the next, and there's a lot of beauty in that. And sometimes we lose sight of that. And so today might be a good chance for us to reflect on that and praise God for that. But again, we do not celebrate a person, but I think it is pretty cool that St. Patrick's Day is this like nationally recognized holiday celebrating a missionary and the work that he did. And so praise God for that. Praise God for that. And let's also be praying for our many missionaries out in the field these days. So, excellent. All right, you ready to roll? Okay, let's all stand up, please. Well, Father God, you are the Lord over all the nations, over all the universe. And we are the privileged ones to be able to stand before you now. We come in the name of Jesus. We come by his blood. And Lord, we come once again to express our heart to you, our gratitude to you and for you, for all that you have done for us, the ways that you've worked in our life in the past week and many years. We come to again say thank you, to ascribe worth to you. And we pray that you would again illuminate your truths and help us to come to know you better. So Lord, speak. Commune with us here. Bless this gathering of your people, Lord. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Of Elijah declaring the word of the Lord, and these are the days of your servant Moses, righteousness being restored. And though these are days of great trials, of famine and darkness and sword, still we are the voice in the desert crying, prepare ye the way of the Lord. Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun. Have the trumpet call, lift your voice, it's the year of Jubilee. Doubt of Zion, his salvation comes. And these are the days of Ezekiel, the dry bones becoming as flesh. And these are the days of your servant David, rebuilding a temple of praise. And these are the days of the harvest. The fields are as white in your world. And we are the laborers in your vineyard, declaring the word of the Lord. Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun. And at the trumpet call, lift your voice. It's the year of Jubilee, and out of Zion's hill salvation comes. There's no God like Jehovah, 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 there's no God like Jehovah. 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 Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun. At the trumpet call, lift your voice. It's the year of Jubilee, and out of Zion till salvation comes. Behold, the Lamb who was slain, you ascended to heaven and evermore will reign. At the end of the age, when the earth you reclaim, you will gather the nations before you. And the eyes of all men will be fixed on the Lamb who was crucified. With wisdom and mercy and justice, you reign at your Father's side. And the angels will cry, slain for the world, ruling power. And the earth will reply, you shall reign as the King of all kings and the Lord of all lords. There's a shield in our hand and a sword at our side. There's a fire in our spirits that cannot be denied. Cause the Father's told us, for these you have died, for the nations you gather before you. And the ears of all men need to hear of the Lamb who was crucified, who descended to hell yet was raised up to reign at his Father's side. And the angels will cry, hey, for the world, ruling power. And the earth will reply, you shall reign as the King of all kings and the Lord of all lords.
Thank
our side. There's a fire in our spirits that cannot be denied. Cause the fathers told us, for these you have died. For the nation to gather before you. And the ears of all men need to hear of the Lamb who was crucified. Who descended to hell yet was raised up to reign at his Father's side. And the angels will cry, Hail the Lamb, who's played for the world. And the earth will reply, You shall reign as the King of all kings and the Lord of all lords. And the angels will cry, Hail the Lamb, who slayed for the world, ruling power. And the earth will reply, of all kings and the Lord of all God before time. We are a vapor, but you are eternal. Love everlasting, reigning on high. Holy, holy Lord God Almighty, worthy the Lamb who was slain. Highest praises, honor, and glory be unto your name. Be unto your name. We Jesus, Redeemer, mighty to save. You are the love song that we'll sing forever. Bowing before you, blessing your name. Holy, holy Lord God Almighty. The Lamb who was
but you can have a seat.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Lord, hear our prayer. All I am and have and ever hope to be, these are yours. Makes me think of the heart of many missionaries who have given of themselves to serve you in incredible ways, to give up such luxuries that this country offers, to go out and spread your word. Lord, we're grateful for every one of them. And I want to pray for missionaries around the globe this morning who are out there doing your work in difficult places, who are just experiencing difficulties. They are the minority, yet they're trying to make you known. And Lord, we pray for them that you would protect them and provide for them, and that their ministry would bear fruit. Thank you, Lord. But I pray for us as well, because you have given us the same calling to go and make disciples. And we don't need to leave this country to do that. So, Lord, I pray for us as a church. Help us, Lord, to bear witness of you, to help others to come to know you. Provide for us opportunities to speak of you and to share about how much you mean to us and what you have done for us. I pray for our community. And I pray that we could be a light to this community. So help us, Lord. Empower us and give us all that's needed to accomplish your work. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Can come on up.
That they can learn to worship you more and more through their song, through their words, prayers to you, talking to you, but also in the way that they live their lives. And may Children's Church be a time, as the teachers help them to understand you better, may it be a time that they learn a deeper relationship with you, where they can worship you more and more each day. And I ask this in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Good morning. Wasn't that wonderful, having the Irish music? It just puts a little hop in your step and a little joy to your heart. I saw somebody today that came in, and I was like, you know, sometimes you haven't seen somebody a little bit over the winter, and they, you know, they just look a little different. Well, his shoulders were back, and he just looked confident and strong, like he'd been working out. I mean, who is that? That's Dave Emery. That's Steve Emery with his twins back there. His shoulders just, he's looking like a proud dad. Becky, congratulations. So excited for you guys. Twin boys back there in church. So their first church service, right? First church service. That's wonderful. Well, yesterday I had a wedding here at the church, which was wonderful. And the passage that we looked at was from Hebrews 12, just the first couple of verses of Hebrews 12. It talks about all that we go through in life, and kind of the focal point was to look at Jesus, right? You're going through all this stuff, but looking to Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith. And it said, look at how he went through the suffering. And it was the joy that was set before him that was leading him to endure the cross. So we're kind of doing a little two-week series. This is the second of 2 weeks. And then, let's see, Ernest is preaching this next week. Right, Ernest, we still on? Good. Because I'm leaving the state. And if Ernest doesn't do it, you're in trouble. And then the following week for Palm Sunday, Tyson is going to preach. So it'll be nice to have a break from me. And it'll be nice to have a break. So for a couple weeks here, I just wanted to kind of lead in to Holy Week. We're not there yet, but sometimes it's kind of a, you know, in our tradition, we're not quite as, like I said, close to the church calendar and always feeling like we have to do things the way you know, the more liturgically based churches have done things. That's kind of part of our ethos. Is we're not even good Baptists. We're non-denominational Baptists. We kind of do things our own way. But I think there is some value to thinking about Jesus in his life. You know, we kind of really hit Christmas hard, and then and we lead up to that maybe a little better. And then I think, you know, now we're kind of leading up towards Holy Week or towards Easter. And so I just wanted to spend a couple weeks just thinking about, for my own sake, and then hopefully for yours as well, to think about how amazing the life of Jesus was. And we talk about his teachings, and we talk a lot of times about how what he accomplished on our behalf in the heavenly realms, and all that is really super duper central to what we're all about. I don't want to take anything away from that. But we definitely do that, and we'll do that through Easter time. But I guess, you know, just sometimes it's nice to just think about, wow, what was it like for him to come and be a human being and to live amongst us and to care for people and to show us how to live. So I guess when I think about it, I just preached this at a wedding yesterday, but we can get help. I think sometimes when we go through life, there's a lot of questions, and I think we're living in more confusing times. There's just a lot of confusion all around us, and sometimes we look for our answers in all sorts of other places, right? We go to all sorts of places, or nowadays you have thoughts and answers on social media everywhere. Everybody's just kind of what everybody is thinking and talking about, and you kind of jump into that mix, whatever you want to call that. And then, you know, sometimes now we have all sorts of different ways to get news and media, and a lot of us like our favorite kind of talking heads that we like to listen to and whatever slant they have. And you're just kind of filling your head with a lot of things, and you can, you know, you don't even need to house clean with an empty head, right? You know, you can just set, anybody else do that? I like to do that. You know, I'm going to fold laundry while I'm going to get a podcast going. I just need to have somebody talking to me at all times. And sometimes it's nice to just stop and think about who Christ is. And when he came, how did he live? And how did his life and the way that he lived and the way that he taught, how does that speak into our world? How does that speak into our decisions? How does that speak into the complexities of what we're facing? So we've got 2 weeks of just, I'm calling them little scriptural meditations almost like, but I somehow tie them all together into a sermon. And we'll move through a number of passages today. And this one's just going to look at that, again, self-sacrificial, humble approach of Jesus. And I'm just kind of tying in for our title on, he had nowhere to lay his head. And just think about that. The King of Kings and the Lord of Lords came and humbled himself to the point that he could say, I got nowhere to lay my head for tonight. All right, let's open our time with a word of prayer. Lord, there are a lot of examples, and we're told that truth is important in your word. And I think we, many of us, focus in on truth and wanting to have it and wanting to declare it, but I pray that we would also have humility, the humility that you had, the way that you brought truth. Yeah, there were hard moments, and you spoke, your son spoke with tough words at times. But overall, his witness was just surrounded by this incredible example of self-sacrifice and a loving kindness for others. And I pray that that might be an example that we allow to speak into our lives. Bless us today as we think of your son. In Jesus' name, amen. I think he likes to answer that prayer, by the way, don't you think? Bless us as we think of your son. He probably enjoys us thinking about his son. All right, well, nowhere to lay his head. And I've got two sacrifices that I want to focus in on, things that Jesus sacrificed in being a human. And then kind of how did he do that will be the third point, if that helps you to kind of see where I'm going. Okay, number one, the road to Calvary. When I say Calvary, what am I talking about? The place where he died, right? I shouldn't always forget the Golgotha or Calvary. It was the place where the crosses were set. So when I say the road to Calvary, so the road to completing his mission, the end of his mission, his death and his resurrection, the path to get there, well, okay, the road to Calvary was without comforts and security of material possessions. Now, it's easy for us to just let that roll off and say that that was the fact, which it was, that he didn't have so much of what we had. And Tyson just said that a little earlier, talking about missionaries, and we're going to kind of talk about missionaries here today too. But, you know, Jesus had created the whole universe, right? He's the agent. He's the God's wisdom at God's side. He's the craftsman, the one that is seen as creating all things, and yet he had complete ownership and entitlement to all things, and yet he chose to go without. And with that comes both comfort, right? We like our stuff, and security. You're safer with the things that you have, or you may feel that way. All right, let's look at some verses on that. Matthew 8, 19 and 20. A scribe came up to Jesus, so this is around the Sea of Galilee, and the crowds are kind of following Jesus around, and he has different responses, but this time he says, well, I'm going to go to the other side, and he kind of avoided the crowds for a little bit. He had just spent a lot of time with them, and so he's moving around, and a scribe came up to him and said, Teacher, I will follow you wherever you go. And Jesus said to him, Foxes have holes, and birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head. Now, what is he saying there? I think he's saying, well, to follow me might not be what you think it means. Maybe you think I'm somebody great. Maybe you think I'm headed in a direction that's going to lead to fame and fortune and power. Maybe you want to join. Maybe you want to join early, right? You want to get in on somebody that's going to be great. Oh, I see a lot of potential in that guy. I want to follow him and see where this goes. And he's basically saying to follow me is going to be marked by sacrifice. And of course, he's talking about the first century. But I think you can expand that to our time still today. I think a lot of people think to follow Jesus means you're going to get the good stuff, right? And are there things that you get in following Jesus? Yes, they're of a deeper nature. But are they always the surfacey? You know, every prayer you ask for, you're going to receive something. I think a lot of people, a lot of people really think that that's what a relationship with God is like. And no matter how many times you say that's not really what it's like, people still think that if I pray to God, or if I'm faithful, or if I do that, if I scratch his back, he's going to scratch mine. And listen, I'm saying following Jesus, you do get reward, but it's not always of a material nature. You don't always get what you want to. If you've been in the faith long enough, you know a lot of times your prayers go up, and then the Lord has a little different answer than the one that you have. But he always has your best in mind. But this whole, well, oh, I really, 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 really want this, so I'm going to go to church this week. Or, you know, I shouldn't pick on the guys down at the jail, but, you know, going down there for 10 years, I mean, it was amazing how many times, hey, that's great, what brought you to Bible study today? You know, I'd always ask that. I love those guys. And I don't know how many times I said, well, I got, you know, what would it be, my hearing or my sentencing is coming up this next week. And I'm like, oh, good. And I like that. And I think it's good to come. But you're always kind of fighting, well, what if the sentencing doesn't go well? You know, does it kind of squash? And sometimes I would see guys not there after sentencing. And they'd say, well, he's pretty ticked off about, they made a deal and the judge actually gave him more than what the deal, anyways, I'm getting into too much detail there. But, you know, people I think have that impression. But Jesus saying sometimes to follow me, and in many ways, you're going to have sacrifices. And it's not going to go easy for you in this world. And here he's saying right in the first century, he didn't have a place to sleep, right? He was just going to sleep somewhere. And amazingly, Jesus, the Son of God, lived this kind of traveling, I don't know if you call him homeless, but what's that called? When nomadic lifestyle, you know, teaching nomadic lifestyle, or you move around. Well, we're told by Jesus, right, that his people were going to be marked by a little different way at looking at stuff. How are you doing with this? He says, do not lay up for yourselves treasures on earth where moth and rust destroy and where thieves break in and steal, but lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven where neither moth nor rust destroys, where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. I like the way that's said at the end. Have you ever looked at that and thought, oh, that's a little different way to say it? I sometimes think he's saying, watch your heart. Because wherever your heart is, that's what you're going to pursue. And I think that's true too. But actually, he's saying here, be careful about what you're doing, because what you do can affect your heart. And he's saying what you're going after, be thoughtful about your movements. Be thoughtful about your actions. Be thoughtful about what you invest in. Because sometimes when you invest a lot in the here and now, your heart ends up wanting that more. Or your heart ends up prioritizing the here and the now. And Jesus is saying, I want my followers are going to be marked by eternal thoughts. They're going to be marked by thoughts of eternity. And again, I say this, sometimes you see that in people's lives where they start to prioritize eternity. And it's amazing how many times you see that later in life. So it's really hard to get young ones to think about eternity because they have so much. I mean, I'm not going through a midlife crisis, and Higgins doesn't like it when I say that I'm old. But if there's a hill, I have to be on the other side. I have to be on the over the hill side. What am I? Oh, I'm 49 now. I think that's the first time I publicly said that. Had a birthday this last week. I'm 49. Oh, as you say, 48. 49. And now, you know, you just can't help but to think, you know, but when you're 20-something, it just seems like life it's just overwhelmingly long. You know, like you have so much time and so many things that eternity can. It's harder to get young people to actually live now thinking about eternity. And I'm storing, I'm not just getting something out of this. I'm serving the Lord and his pleasure and that's my reward. And that's something that he's going to reward me. Jesus says you can look toward that, towards heavenly reward. And sometimes you see that later in life. So, I mean, I think there's reason to look at our elders, you know, and I'm talking the older folks around us, and to look at the way that they view stuff. You know, probably not in every example, but sometimes it just seems less important to them because they're having more of an eternal perspective and they're recognizing what is to come next. 1 Timothy 6 is kind of a long sentence. I couldn't find a punctuation at the beginning or end. I just have one sentence in there, but it's a great passage where Paul, it's probably my favorite passage, talking about stewardship and money management. But he talks about people that are trying to use godliness to get stuff in the here and now. And Paul says, oh, that's horrible, right? And he basically, the line there that I think is wonderful, he says, but godliness with contentment is great gain. So it's kind of like, you know, we have stuff, right? You have clothes. Some of you, I put on a nice little tie, you know, we have stuff, right? But I think it's like Paul's saying here, we're not supposed to hold on to it too tightly. And I don't know if you, that's not easy to do. And I can't really speak that into your life and your situation, all the things that you have that maybe the Lord is saying, you know, maybe just don't hold that so tightly. Maybe it's okay to have, and maybe that's stewardship for God to give you stuff, but can you not hold it so tightly? And I think Paul is saying there, godliness with contentment. So you're content with what you have, you're glad for what you have, but you're not maybe not holding it so tightly and kind of grabbing and trying to get others and so fixated and stressed out when you don't have the here and now. I think I learned this lesson in part from my father-in-law, my wife's, well, I guess there's only one way to have a father-in-law. Brother-in-laws can be a little trickier, but father-in-law, I could just say father-in-law, but my father-in-law, I mean, he did pretty well. Kokomo, Indiana, worked at GM, great pension, doing really well. But kind of life twisted out of control and had some trouble, you know, in later adult years and got his life back on track with the Lord or came to know Christ, depending on how you look at his younger conversion. But, you know, he just was walking with the Lord. And once he came to know, I mean, he was absolutely sold out. Everything was all about the Lord. And all that he had lost, in the end, almost became like a blessing. Like he saw all this huge tower and all that he was building and, you know, in this life. It just, it meant nothing to him. Do you say selfish?
I said rubbish.
It was rubbish. It didn't mean anything. Yeah, you got a little Philippians 3 in there. Yeah, it didn't mean anything to him. And then he just kind of lived in this state of not really caring about money. It was kind of interesting. Like money was a tool, you know, and it was coming, but it came in and out, and it was very, very free and really died with nothing, if I can, I'm not trying to dishonor him in saying that, but kind of died with nothing. And yet he had this beautiful, powerful testimony through his later years. He kind of lost everything, and then he found what was really important, and he lived in that. And I think that's a powerful example for me of godliness and then being content and grateful with what he had. And that's going to be a struggle. And again, I can't tell you in your situation exactly what the Lord is saying for you, but I think Christians ought to be different than the rest of the world. We should not be marked with greed. We should not be marked with hanging on so tightly. Yes, we're stewards. Yes, there are some stresses. Maybe you have financial stress right now, all right? And I'm speaking to you in your stress, and you're saying, well, I don't have to worry about holding on too tight. I'm trying to get by. And I understand that there are real reasons for accepting the challenges that God puts before us and taking great responsibility in those moments. It's not about being wild and loose with our finances. We should be good stewards, right? Good stewards, but not hanging on to the things of this world too tightly. Well, Jesus, what are you worried about losing that Jesus had as he began his 3-year ministry on the earth? What are you going to lose that you're so worried about? Did Jesus have that? You know, he gave everything, and he just served the Lord and walked with him and trusted him. All right, and then the second thing I wanted to say about Jesus and what he gave was the road to Calvary was the embrace of a short life. Do you ever think about the fact that Jesus was so young when he died? I think about it the older I get. You know, when I was about 33 or somewhere in there, I remember thinking, wow, that was it. That was all that he lived. Well, Jesus saw the end in the Garden of Gethsemane. And he saw all that he was about to face on the cross. Jonathan Edwards calls it the cup of God's wrath. He saw it and had to fully embrace it. And part of that embrace, of course, was incredible suffering that he was just about to face. But I would argue the other part was a short life. His life being taken. And I think we all grieve when, I think, any life is lost. But there is something especially tragic when a young person dies. And we say, oh, they never got to experience this. They never. Well, guess what? Jesus never got married. Jesus never had kids. Jesus never had quite a career, but he gave up a worldly career, right? And he never had a big house. And again, never had that inheritance of family to look for. He was willing to give that all up for you and for me. Well, we're making a trip, as I said. I don't know if I'm supposed to always tell everybody where I'm going and up to, but we're making a long trip down south this next week for spring break, or over next weekend and the next week. And so I don't know if some of you, when you drive, you like to listen to something. Again, I need to have somebody talking into my head. And if everybody, we're going to go drive overnight, so I need somebody talking to me. And so I like to do Audible. Do you guys like to listen to some books on tape and stuff like that? And so what I've done, this is my strategy, was to grab a few books of things that I'd really like to listen to, but they might be a little boring at the start. So I have to whet my appetite with them. Am I getting into this too much? So as I'm doing my laundry now, I'm listening to books on tape and kind of working through the background stuff. So three of the books that I'm going, I wanted to do the diary of David Brainerd, famous missionary from the 1700s, who inspired Jim Elliot and William Carey and a lot of the great missionaries, so really old missionary biography. And then the Ecuadorian Martyrs, Jim Elliot Through Gates of Splendor. I want to read that one. And then Corrie Ten Boom, The Hiding Place. Have you guys all read that one? And that would be, you know, World War II. She was involved in her family in hiding Jews during that time and helping get them to safety. And so I'm trying to get myself into like the captivating parts. So they're doing the background and they're all interacting, and Roger Udarian was this and Pete Fleming was that, and he came from this background, and just want to work through. I want to get to where I can't fall asleep when I'm driving. So I'm listening to it, but as I'm preparing for this message, I'm going, oh my goodness, I'm grabbing onto people that did not hang onto their life tightly, right? They were willing to die. And I don't know how do you get that mindset? Now, Corrie Ten Boom was about my age when World War II was taking place. I think in 1942, she would have been 41. She would have been my age. And that's right when things started heating up for her. But then you got all these guys, these young guys. Five young men decide, and the language of what they were saying, they knew they were. I mean, it was maybe likely that they were going to die. They were going to go to, you know, there were different remote tribes in Ecuador, and this was one that had been, there had just been nothing but like, you know, somebody's going to get killed in these kind of exchanges. And they were going to go there and just give themselves to the Lord. And then, of course, way back in the 1700s, you had this David Brainerd guy. He died when he was 29. Gave everything that he had, his health and everything, just to share Christ with the Native Americans. And then in the, it'd be the 1956, I think January 8th, is when the Ecuadorian Martyrs. You know how young those guys were that died? 27, 28, 28, 31, and 32. And think of what they left behind. Most of them were married, maybe all of them were. I'll learn more next week, but they had their little families started. You know, I don't know, do you hang on to this life so tightly that you really wouldn't be of much use for the Lord if he called you to do something that was costly? or risky for his purposes. And maybe he'll call you to do something like that. Maybe he won't. But I know he wants us to live this life in the here and now with an eternal perspective. Amen? He's wanting us to live life in the here and now, just not as everybody else who is of this world. He wants us to live as though we're from another world. And going a little farther, he fell on his face and prayed, "Oh, okay, Father, if it be possible, let this cup pass from me." So there's Jesus struggling. I want to read another passage that maybe you've heard and inspired Jim Elliot from Matthew 16, that Jesus told his disciples. So it's not only what Jesus did, but it's what he asked of us. "If anyone would come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me." Okay, so I've quoted that many times. It seems like I've been drawn back to that verse a lot lately. If you want to come after me, deny yourself, right? Which is very anti-American, right? Or like, feed yourself. Deny yourself, take up your cross, and follow me. And then he says this, "Whoever would save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake will find it. For what will it profit a man if he gains the whole world and forfeits his soul? Or what shall a man give in return for his soul?" Oh, there is a way to live. What is the Lord saying right now to you in your life? What are you holding on to too tightly? What are you worried about saying? Maybe you're way far away from being willing to give your life. You don't even want your reputation, or you don't want that person at work to think you're weird, and you won't even share about Christ. Well, here those guys get over there, and they set up this, they're dropping gifts to the people there, and then they jump on, and they set up kind of a little beach landing spot on January 3rd, and by January 8th, they're dead. 5 days there. I mean, what's the point? That's ridiculous. What a waste. Well, you guys know how that story goes. Then in come these courageous wives and sisters and others that came into the tribe, and they risked their lives. I mean, Elizabeth Elliot brought her little girl in with her. I mean, risked her life. And God did an amazing work. The 5 days that those boys, they're boys, 32, I think, was the oldest of the bunch, Pete Fleming. And they gave up their lives. That's what Jesus is calling us to be willing to do, to live for him as he lived. Wow, can you imagine? I mean, what stage of life would you be willing to go for his sake? I'll tell you, when I had little kids, I felt all very responsible to drive more carefully, right? Because I had a lot to live for, you know? And then you get, wow, I got to get these kids through college and, you know, get them launched into life. You know, there's hardly, oh, I got grandkids coming. You know, when are you willing to give of yourself? I think sometimes we see what God has for us, and I see it sometimes with a diagnosis. Somebody says, wow, is that my story? A short life. It's not to be long. You have to battle that. That's a struggle. I don't know how you accept that. I mean, we don't know. We don't know the number of days that we have. And sometimes you find out what your story is. And it's not one that has all that there is to offer in this life. And Jesus didn't. He didn't get married. He didn't have kids. He didn't have a big inheritance to leave. Well, he did, but a different kind of one. Love when Jesus restores Peter. Isn't that great? "Do you love me?" "You know I love you, Lord. Feed my sheep." "You love me?" Kind of the same thing, very similar, three times. It's just a beautiful little restoration of Peter. And then Jesus says this, "Truly, I do." It's this beautiful, you could just hear the music. And then all of a sudden the music has to change for what Jesus says. "Truly, truly, I say to you, when you were young, you used to dress yourself and walk wherever you wanted. But when you are old, you will stretch out your hands and another will dress you and carry you to where you do not want to go." This he said to show by what kind of death Peter was to glorify God. And after saying this, he said to him, follow me. How does Peter die? Stretched out, he's taken, and he's crucified. Church history says he's crucified. They actually say upside down in history. That's Jesus saying, you're restored, Peter. Here's your mission. Go and serve me. I'm not promising you a long life. I'm not promising that your story gets to be what you hoped it would be. I'm not promising that you're going to have all the fame and riches and comforts and security of this life. In fact, I'm telling you right now, the death by which you're going to glorify me. I wonder what kind of death God has in mind for you to glorify him. I mean, that's the whole point of why we're here. Sometimes you have to open up and let God give you, receive. But don't hold it tightly, right? We're not to be holding. Jesus was, he was willing to hold the things of this world loosely. Some of you like Ephesians 1, I sure do. As it is my eager expectation and hope that I will not be ashamed talking about his imprisonment and all that he was going through in Philippians 1 here. That with full courage now as always, Christ will be honored by, this is Paul, in my body, whether by life or by death. For me to live is Christ and to die is gain. It's a great verse. He kind of goes on from there. But one way or another, we live. Maybe your story is a long life. Maybe you're going to be blessed that way and use that long life to glorify God. And maybe your story is to have a shorter life or a very short life. Use that life to glorify God. Well, Paul right here is saying, I know what I want. He's saying, I know I want to be in heaven. That's much, much better. Paul didn't live a long life either. All right, well, how do you get that perspective? I just want to even say, even Jesus had some work to do. I know he's the Son of God, but he had rhythms in his life to draw him to the Father. He had rhythms in his life to keep his perspective right. And you may feel like, well, since he was God, this is all effortless. And I'm just saying, even the Garden of Gethsemane, it was work. It was work. And he accepted that work in being fully human. Somehow, that's an amazing mix. Somehow, it was work. And he worked. His road to Calvary was accompanied by time and attention to an eternal perspective. I love when he goes to Capernaum, which is where Peter is from, and he goes there and he teaches, and it says everybody at the synagogue was astonished by the way that he was teaching and with such authority. And then he is confronted by demons, and he says, be quiet and get out of them. And all of a sudden, even more of a stir. Whoa, and the crowds were all coming. Capernaum was kind of set on fire, and then he goes over to Peter's mother-in-law, right? So Peter's mother-in-law. Peter was married, by the way. So he heals her. He heals Peter's mother-in-law, and it just feels like they're rolling. And maybe he would just be like, whoa, I'm going to sleep in on this one. Wow, that was quite a day of ministry, and wow, lots of attention and a lot more to be done. And in the morning, Peter wakes up and is like, where's Jesus? And rising very early in the morning, while it was still dark, he departed and went into a desolate place, that's Jesus, and there he prayed. And Simon and those who were with him searched for him, and they found him and said to him, everyone is looking for you. And I can just imagine, and I know I'm imagining, I just imagine Jesus smiling there, and he said to them, well, let's go to the next towns that I may preach there also. For that is why I came out. But in between this fantastic ministry experience and this next fantastic ministry experience, Jesus has to get away and spend time with the Lord. I pray that you have regular, if you feel like, oh, I just don't feel, I don't know what you're talking about. These Ecuadorian martyrs, well, that's neat to think about, right? David Brainerd, oh man, that's amazing that he had tuberculosis and coughed his way to his death at 29, gave everything he had. Yeah. Oh man, Corrie Ten Boom hiding. Wow, she was willing to get. She made a decision when you started hiding Jews. Wow, you're putting your life. She didn't hold it tightly. Well, maybe you feel like there's superhero Christians and then there's me. And I guess I just want to conclude by saying Jesus even snuck away to get refreshed in the Lord and to draw close to him and to be ready for what the Lord had for him next. And if Jesus needed that time and that getaway, you need it too. You need it too. Coming to church is good. I feel like I don't want to make that sound like it's bad. It's wonderful that you come to church, but it's more than that. You need time with the Lord. You need time with other believers too. Get involved in a weekly Bible study. Spend daily or regular times in prayer with the Lord. There are multiple layers to this relationship and to be strengthened with an eternal perspective. And that's what we're called to have ourselves. Colossians 3, if then you have been raised with Christ, seek the things that are above where Christ is, seated at the right hand of God. Set your mind on things that are above, not on the things that are on earth. For you have died and your life is hidden with Christ in God. I'm the first to say, I spend too much time listening to the things that are happening on earth, right? I need to focus my mind. I felt that this week. At one point, I was like, I'm going to watch another video while I work on this project or work out or whatever I do next. I just like to hear things. I'm like, what would be edifying to me spiritually, not just stimulating to my mind? It takes work to have your mind set in the Lord and think about what he's done. Think about what you have received through Christ. Think about what we're here for and allow that to change the way that we live. Amen? All right, stand with me. Let's close with a word of prayer. Help us, Lord. Your son took, what an unusual, unlikely path for the Son of God to take. What a wonder to look at him. Lord, I pray that we'd spend more time thinking about Jesus. I pray that we'd spend more time in your word. I pray that we'd spend more time talking to you, Lord. Help us to live here. It's a very confusing and complicated world. So many other voices out there. Help us to listen to you. Help us to look to your son. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Now to him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you blameless before the presence of his glory with great joy, to the only God, our Savior, through Jesus Christ our Lord, be glory, majesty, dominion, and authority before all time and now and forever. And all God's people said,
Amen.
Would you turn and greet one another as you go to